rub eggs and come sit with us.
Okay. You want to stand? Feel free to stand as well. So thank you to everybody who has been on the panel. Also, I wanted to say thank you to Don and Kyra, who is somewhere in the audience. Got there. Don has been very helpful in dealing with me on all things women veterans in the DC office. Don's the deputy director for National Veteran Services. She covers all
well. So a multi-pronged effort in terms of doing that outreach. And I'm so thrilled to see so many of you here. I came last year and not quite as many folks in the room, so I'm really excited to see the tremendous strides we made here in DFW, and I can't wait to continue partnering with Kata and all of you on our shared work.
Thank you, Kayla. So I'm gonna ask one more question before I throw it out to all you ladies and gentlemen to start throwing the girls here questions. But when I first came on at DFW, I haven't been here the longest, to be honest on that. It's been a little over a year and a half. These three ladies, as well as Nancy, who's here in the audience, who's also on the committee, had just started to put together a survey on women veterans that we were sending out to membership. We ended up having about 2,000 respondents, and it was over quite a lot, so it was a lot of information that we got to put together from that. From that survey, we tried breaking it down into different categories so we could better understand what the needs and wants of female veterans were. What do we need to do from a VFW perspective with legislation? What did we need to do for service officers? What did we need to do for recognition and posts to get more involvement going? So Marlene, if you want to explain what those four categories were that we broke it down into?
How many may have taken that survey? We sent it out through email, Facebook. Does anybody remember taking it? It was just a 50 question kind of thing. We ended up breaking it down to four categories. It was homelessness, health, recognition, and outreach. It gave us a lot of insight, I think, as we had taken all the answers, the staff and headquarters at DC, cleaned it out enough. And that was, if you want to hear all the stats on that, Commander Chief Jeske had actually used a lot of that stats in his testimonial at DC, the Legislative Conference from Congress. I think that really helped us to have sort of have an understanding of a starting point for us. And our hope was, and we hope the committee goes forward with honing in on some of this in more particular measures. And if you guys have any insight or other things that you want to add or might want to fit in one of these categories, let us know so that we can pay attention to that, because that's what you're here for. Help us gain information and insight of what you're thinking or what you need. Okay?
So do we have any questions, or do you want me to keep asking the boring questions? She beat you to the bar. Yes, ma'am. Oh, we have a microphone as well.
Tina Shields, Department of Mississippi, Post 5931, out of Pasquashan. I would like to know how we can expand the women's clinics at our VAs to include more doctors. Right now, at my VA, which is the Biloxi VA, the first doctor that came on board, she was there 6 months after I started. She left. It took them close to 2 years to get a PA in that clinic. In the meantime, I was seen out at the regular clinic. No continuity of care. Once the PA came on board, this is a PA, not a full-fledged doctor, but a PA. She was there by herself for close to 2 years before they got a doctor on board. Their caseload for the number of female veterans in my area is unbelievable. The last time I was there, I think my coat was like at 1 o'clock, and I said, ma'am, did you by chance get lunch? No. And we just kind of had a personal conversation. Majority of the time, she doesn't get lunch. She might get a bite or two of the test to do the next time. So can we work on getting more doctors in the women's clinic and expand that? Because right now there's 4 clinics for the rest of the VA population in Biloxi. There's 2 doctors for the entire women's clinic. So my question is, can we work on getting more doctors in our women's clinic that deal with just the women's issues?
I do know that we currently have at least one designated women's health provider in every VA medical center, 100% of VA medical centers, and 90% of CBOCs. And the goal is to make sure that 85% of women veterans are assigned to a designated women's health provider. We'd like to be higher, but if we have women veterans who are assigned to a doctor and don't want to change, we're not going to force you to change doctors. It isn't a designated women's health provider. How to make sure that every single site has the right number of doctors is a challenge that I'm not personally equipped to tackle, and I don't envy the folks who do. But know that we know that women are one of the fastest growing subpopulations of veterans. The number of women veterans is climbing rapidly, and based on the projections, we are working very hard to make sure that we have the right number of providers to meet their needs at all locations. I will also note, it's one of the reasons that the raising awareness and changing culture matters. I've talked to providers who said, I wanted to treat women, so I didn't even think about applying to VA. Like, there are docs graduating from medical school who don't think of VA as a place that they can treat women. So raising that awareness that yes, VA does treat women is something that we all have to work on and I'm working on. And I also do want to make sure that I mention, because I want everyone to be able to share with the women that you know who may not use VA, please know that despite, as you know, the fact that there are some challenges in some locations, if you look at the meta level, at the system-wide level, women who use VA for care are more likely to get gender-specific care in VA than in other systems of care. So you're more likely to get a cervical cancer screening and a breast cancer screening on time in VA than if you use any other system of care, private insurance, Medicare, Medicaid, DOD, any other system. So come into VA, you will get the evidence-based care that you can earn with your service, and we are working very hard to address the access challenges, the culture change issues, and so forth that exist. But on some of these very important dimensions, like, are you gonna get the care that you're supposed to get when you're supposed to get it? It's more likely to be able to for us.
Suggestion for you. You might want to advertise like a women veterans, like a little meeting, coffee, donuts, that kind of thing, and bring them in just for a meeting together. Some women feel more confident or better or whatever you want to use, coming in maybe together as opposed to individually.
Right.
So if you can get a couple of key ones to come in, at least have a meeting, sit down, explain what the VAs or VFW is all about. Where they can get active, how it can benefit them. They may sign up and then be willing to come into a meeting together.
I appreciate
that.
Thank you.
Yes, I'd like to make a statement since it was brought up about the different issues of the VAs and stuff. I'm well aware that there is a major problem there. And it is not just the women veterans, you're not dealing with this on your own. We go in there fighting for the women veterans also. I can tell you that I needed a mammogram done, and I could not get one done at the VA hospital in Ohio. I actually had to go to Wright-Patterson Air Force Base to a woman doctor there in order to get it done. I feel your issues, and you're not in this alone. There are a lot of the male veterans that are right there with you.
thank you for that, sir. I agree. Even in my MBA, we have a wonderful women's clinic. It's very well staffed. As a matter of fact, they just expanded and took over half the floor, which is awesome. But yet, like, we have a tough time with dermatology. You know, there's one doc, they float in and out, they come, they go. Yeah, so there are other clinics that do that as well. My suggestion would be make sure that you get more people enrolled, and if you can, I don't know if this happens in other VAs, my VA, we have a veterans board that actually is sort of like a liaison between the staff of the VA and the veterans themselves. And we've brought a lot of these issues to the staff and said, this is what we're seeing, this is what we need, and how do we go about, is it a budget thing, is it maybe you can't get the doctors? And we sit down with them and they tell us what's going on. Because I think it comes across both ways. Buffalo has a hard time with dermatology doctors anyway in Buffalo, so you get a couple of them to stay in the VA was even more so. So yeah, it's sometimes it goes to what the clinic is, but I feel in the women's area, where she's dealing out with Luxy, maybe getting more women enrolled and pushing, start giving a voice, say, if you meet with the director and say, hey, we really, you know, we've got X amount of women coming here, and yet we're not getting the services we need. Being politely squeaky at first, maybe chew in the door and a conversation, and if the director is forthcoming, they'll explain what's going on and how they go about getting things done. They can start there. That's all. It's worked in Buffalo, that's all I can tell you.
Hi, my name is Jean McBee. I'm a board master of course 8214 out of Manchester, New Hampshire. And talking about the healthcare and the women's clinics, we don't have a hospital, one of the few states that don't have a VA hospital. So when it comes to mammograms, I'm bringing that up because I've been waiting now over 2 years to get a mammogram. I'm still waiting for them to set up for me to go out of the VA like they usually do. And we were doing very well before, and now it's kind of turned the other way. They're not taking care of us women as good as they used to.
Can you give your card or contact info later so I can have somebody follow up with you? Because that sounds like a very long wait.
Staying with family or friends?
It's just, it just brings VA in alignment with the rest of the federal government under the HEARTS Act to include those who are fleeing domestic violence. So if you're fleeing domestic violence and capturing, then that would theoretically, I would imagine, meet that definition. Yes, ma'am.
Nancy Clark, from Rockford, Illinois, 5149. I'm the senior vice commander there. I'm also the District 6 membership and hospital and chief of staff. And as a hospital chair, I deal with that at Madison VA. And I want to give you all some information about that. There is an Amish vet there, Sandra Schumacher, who's the director of women's health care. And she recently set up a sister, whereby in that women's program, she modeled it after what they had in Milwaukee. She's hoping that this is going to go VA-wide. What it is yes, it, that's, yeah, because everybody, the guys call it sister to sister. That's not, it's a sister, a sister, whereby when a female veteran gets into the system and she knows she may be suffering MST, PTSD, et cetera, and can't navigate that system, we have gone through training and we become the assistant for her, and there we are given a bag, so there's, you know, low key identification, but it is something that our sister will know about. And we walk her through the processes as much as she wants us to, and it is an awesome program. We have two CBOCs, the Rockford CBOC in Freeport, Illinois CBOC involved in it, and I'm on the advocacy council for the CBOCs there, also to make sure that this program is working wonderfully. And so I'm hoping that maybe you might contact Sandra Schumacher and find out how she is doing it there, and maybe that would be a good model to look at having at more VAs. And it might be something you're already doing.
Well, thank you for the sneak peek, and everyone stay tuned for future announcements.
Oh, it's exciting. I really hope you do. More questions? Yes, ma'am. Rose asking a lot of questions.
Tammy Walter, Commander, Post 1796, White Pinion City, Arizona. Me being a 27-year combat veteran, I move a lot. And to navigate the VA from state to state is horrible. You don't get the same care from state to state, which you should. Now that I'm in Arizona, I've been waiting almost 2.5 years to see a dentist. It's uncalled for. And I mean, I know it's through the whole VA with men and women that when you move from one state to another, you would expect the care you get one state, you would get in the next state. It doesn't work that way. I fought for a year to be in Arizona to cover my classes that Michigan covered. And I still had people in Arizona.
When I moved recently, I was also surprised to find that the electronic medical record was not quite as smooth and universal as I had expected it to be. And to be asked when I put in, oh, when was the last time you got your passport? I'm like, shouldn't that be in your computer? Like, why am I supposed to do that? So I feel your frustration, and I certainly hope that I'm sure you've all heard there are some changes on the horizon for the electronic health record, and I certainly hope that is one of the things that will
Why doesn't the VA communicate with each VA?
I wish, as a patient, I knew the answer to that.
They used to.
Frustration. Yeah, I
hear that. They used to. State to state, VAs could communicate. Now they don't anymore.
So from an NLS standpoint, not myself in particular, because it takes me 5 months to figure out how to turn the TV on. There is somebody else in our staff who understands IT. I'm very happy they get it, because I do not. So we have been working closely with VA, as well as with Congress and the Senate, on ways to move forward with IT infrastructure. Because it is a problem that we do hear from members day in and day out, with the VA communication back and forth, different departments, making sure data isn't being lost, and making sure we maintain that continuity of care that we all know about VA. So fortunately, we are looking at moving forward with that. It is not an easy fix, or at least not to me. As somebody again who needs 5 remotes per team. And it's also going to cost a lot of money, which they should spend. We just have to figure out the best way to move forward. I don't know if all of you knew Ray when he was still with us, but as he puts it, you know, before
before they spend billions of dollars, we should make sure that it's going to work right. Right. So, yes,
I just have a question. I'm Tish McCullough from the Department of Texas, VFW Post 4676, University City. I just want to know who out of these departments still have women veteran chairmen at the state level? Wisconsin. So, like, yell the names of the states, because it's so what I'm asking really is who does not. And I really loved it. I really, really loved it when it was a mandate from national, and it was part of a program that a woman veteran, you have to designate a woman veteran to be your state chairman. I think that in itself, coupled with all the other work that we had done several years ago, really helped to elevate and bring awareness to our male comrades in the department that we're here, we're team players, and we want to be a part of the solution. And then when National decided not to make it a mandate anymore, some states kept it on, Texas of course did. And I know some of the other states who are very forward thinking with bringing in women comrades did. But it's something that I would like for this committee to bring back to National and say, you know, it costs National $0. $0 for each state to appoint a woman veteran chairman. We are not asking to be brought in for conferences. We're not asking to be brought in for special meetings or any of that kind of stuff. But for National to say this is a requirement for you to make All-American as a department commander, this is one of the programs that you need to do, I think that that's really fair. And I would appreciate seeing that being brought back to the table.
The objective was about 3 years for that committee. And it was to focus in on how to bring women in, what issues we could look at, and so forth. I think they had gone the distance on that, or they felt that they had gone the distance on that. They had done it, because if you remember, they did the Iraq-Afghanistan committee at the same time. So eliminating that in the three-year mark wasn't really unexpected. But I understand what you're saying about the women's committee themselves. I think it helps. I even have women now come up to me and say, how do we get women in? And I think that would help the states, the departments as a whole, right down to the post, if we had more communication on how to do that, or key things that have happened, or even just sharing information and say, this is, you know, this is what we're finding, and we'd like to tell you, and what issues you have that we can take back up. Like you said, we're not asking to be brought into national to do anything specific, but maybe just an informational director, like any other committee that we've got.
Absolutely.
Yeah. What she said.
Yes, ma'am.
Kathy Brock from New Mexico. I see one person in here besides me, and Silver, which is out running around. I know Ben Grip is running around. Is there anyone else in this room other than Leon? You're still here. Your hand out. Who participated in the convention in San Antonio in 2002? 2002. Okay, 2003 then.
Thank you.
2003. 2002 is when I moved to New Mexico, so that was a mistake then. In the beginning. Okay, we only had 10 women at that entire convention in 2003. 10. How many past state commanders do we have in the room at the moment?
Yeah.
Okay. I was only number 7 for all of you up front in 2010, so you know you've come a long way, ladies. Now, if you could double that every 10 years, that whole head dais ought to be all female, right?
I would just like to add, I'm sorry, Tina O'Shields, State of Mississippi, Post 5931. I was just told that last year we had 7 state commanders.
Yes.
This year we have none. No females. Last year we had 7. This year we have
none. Last year we had 5. Year, 1 year.
I'm just letting you know that basically there are no female state commanders this year.
And there are still states that have never had a female state commander.
Next year we're going to have another 6 or 7.
Or a suggestion. On the
VFW.org website, it would be nice to have something specifically related to women veterans, especially since there is a panel and there's a committee that you'd be identified. If people in the audience here want to go back home and have questions, suggestions, or any sort of comments, that we have an open forum at National, or that we feel that we have an open forum at National, that we can make some recommendations and suggestions. VFW National has done a great job doing some training programs, right, online. So how about we throw women veterans in there as a subcategory and get some more information, and maybe that can help us with retention and recruiting women veterans into the VFW so that they can actually see. We're not gonna bully, people aren't gonna believe we're doing anything until they see it. Our words only mean one thing. It's our actions that will get people to jump on board. So just again, recommendation, I don't know who did the IT at National, but throwing women veterans into that, I would be very grateful to have something like that, because then I can directly point people in that direction.
So we actually do have a website, vfw.org/womenveterans. Last year when we built the website and we updated all the survey results and different things, VFW does have an offer for women, more links for VA sites and things that we thought would be helpful. That was then rearranged as the entire website went through some rebuilding. And we have been working with our communications department in Kansas City on trying to find a new, I should say, home for the Dropbox to make it more easily accessible. Because I do agree it is a pain to get to if you don't know the link. And if you do forget what it is when you do on it, again, vfw.org/womenveterans. If you just Google VFW Women Veterans, I believe it's the first or second link that comes up. Yes.
Again, Tammy Walter, Post Command 1796. Why don't they just have it at the top of the VFW National website with a link for the women's site? Why don't they just have it? It says, when you go to the VFW National website, why don't you just have it at the top where all the other information tabs are? Women veterans. Yeah.
So I don't build a website. That's not what I do anymore. But there are those. I would love, as again, as me and myself, I would love if we just had like a big picture of, you know, female vet, and you could easily look on it. But there is certain organization that I do not understand to the website. Maybe some of you can explain it a little bit.
I think it's named like Carlos.
Carlos?
Yeah,
what are you pointing at?
So I will take the blame. Our communications team is excellent, and they have been helping me to find a home for that link. So, guaranteed it will be done. Right. And I am open to suggestions. The communication team does this. It actually, it's great that you're all here. If you could give us a suggestion of where to put it.
You just got one.
Yeah, and the National said, website.
Correct.
And
at the
top.
On the ribbon bar.
Under your community.
On the drop down menu bars.
Okay.
That brings up a whole lot of programs and other stuff. Back to
your people. Excellent. Thank you.
We will look into it.
Don't want to write it somewhere else.
Exactly.
Good afternoon. Goodman Met Senior Vice Commander, State of Wisconsin. I'm one of the old timers. Okay.
No.
Now, this is what we need to work on. A couple of things. My very first national convention in Nashville, somebody tapped on my shoulder and said, welcome. That was Priscilla. I have tried through the years, some of you, you might have seen me the first time you ever saw me, I say, welcome. Great you're here. How many of you do that to another woman veteran? We need to make that effort. The other thing we need to do, and Deb, when you said something, Pop, we are responsible. We, the women, we need to set up a mentoring program where we help each other out. We don't have that. Okay, there's so many of us that go through the chairs, or that want to go through the chairs, and we don't get the mentoring from the male counterparts. Okay? We need to get off our own, pardon my expression, I'm an old NCO, asses, yeah. And we need to start our own mentoring program so that we can help each other out to achieve what we're all trying to achieve. Okay? So let's get this appeal we start. And I don't know how we're going to do it, Dom. Maybe we can all talk about it. How we can set up maybe a women mentoring Facebook page or something like that, that we can start with that. So that we can just say, not to let you, that our male comrades out of it, but there's things that we need to discuss that are happening at the state level, at post levels. And it happened to three of us senior vice commanders today when we registered for our senior vice commander, President Auxiliary Luncheon. We went to register and they flipped immediately to the president's page. Okay? So we need to start taking care of this. But if we don't do it, and I know everybody says, I'm sure you'll say something, yes, sir. No. I know, to be bluntly honest, it was on an NCOER, so I guess it's true. But we have to take the own responsibility, is what I'm saying. If we don't start doing something, nobody else is going to do it for us. Okay? Enough said.
She's absolutely correct. On my way here, I got stopped by a couple of comrades, guys that were sitting talking and stuff. Asked them how things were going and stuff, and I asked them if they had a women commander yet, and they said that no, they had 3-4 that were sort of hanging around in the background. They didn't understand why they weren't trying to go up the chairs. And I said, they probably are a little apprehensive. And he says, and how, what do we do with that? And I said, there is a good handful of us women veterans who are past state commanders. Tell them to call us. We're not that hard to find. So that mentoring, I think, would go on a long way, and I explained to them, if they talk to another woman who's been there, done that, they might jump in and be willing to go up the chairs. So it's very true.
I mean, I'm used to pulling it out of my fourth point of contact. because I came from the Women's Army Corps to the Modern Army, 75 to 95, I stood on my 2 feet and said what I thought. Otherwise, they'd walk all over you. So I have no problems doing that now. But things have changed, so what we need to continue, we need to do this mentoring to help everybody along. That's the only way it's going to work.
Can I ask all our first timers to stand up? Welcome, ladies.
Okay, so this is why I said you're not correct. Okay, so April for Sexual Assault Awareness Month, and then November is another awareness month that we were discussing in November.
Yeah, okay. Yes. So I've received word from BJ and DocSmed that we will have a women's committee for those the years that they are commander in chiefs. And we will make sure that the folks behind them also commit to having the women's committee.
You mean just at the national level, right?
That's correct.
Okay. So please bring back to them that we want them to mandate to have a woman chairman at the department too.
Exactly. I'll have Kate deliver that message.
Hey, I have no problem telling on myself, believe me.
We'll all walk in there.
Yep.
Well, that actually would help the women's committee to have a chair in every state. So like when we were pushing out the survey, we could have pushed it out to the women chairs, and they could have pushed it out to their contacts, because we were pushing it from all different directions.
And sadly, I didn't get anything. I didn't get anything. And I'll be the chairman in my state for 5 years in a row until this one thing looks to the current one happen. So
when I was a state commander this past year, didn't know that there was anything like that.
Delaware.
It would have been nice to know.
So for the future, reference to our first point of contact, aside from you blasting things out on social media and whatnot, everybody here wants to annoy Ken Wiseman, who I work with. He manages the Action Corps, if you're not already signed up. So we send things on all surveys that we do through the Action Corps, as well as you get our weekly update, the action alerts, things of that nature. So that's what we pushed it out with when we did that survey, which was January of last year.
So that's a survey, though, but where did you publish that there was a women's committee?
In the world, there was an article.
There was there an article in the weekly? So it was an article in the weekly, apparently, on that one as well.
There were also articles for each of their business because of the work that they did. There ended up being about 4 or 5 articles.
But it wasn't in any of the junior vice, senior vice, commander training?
Or else I don't know that.
How about the general orders?
Yeah. How about you give us some way to communicate with you?
Yes. So I did put some of my cards.
So I'm talking about as a committee. You said you're meeting and all of this and everything. Where can we get that information? Well, my name is Denise Fair, Department of Maryland, State Senior Vice.
Can you just specify, you want more information on the committee? And how you get that?
What I'm hearing from you is that this isn't the only time that you as a committee meet. Like, you do other things throughout the year. Where do we get the information about what you're doing? We want some input into what you're doing. So what do you do with me?
So I'm not on the committee. I get to send them lots of emails and phone calls. Whenever the committee does come into town, though, which in the past has been when we had the legislative conferences, we do write up some press releases. We do a lot of social media. It's mostly outreach. And then, as Ken said, it gets sent out into the Action Corps as well.
The first year I was on, we actually went to the VA. We got the VA.
Considering that as an outreach option. I don't know if it's one of the things that we
can, for a little technical information, we can post it in places on the website that won't cost you anything. And in some of the technology that we have and some of the technology we're looking at, the text message cost will be absorbed by national headquarters. We're working that issue and how we can do that. Also, Kata, just so you know, I can create separate distribution lists within the Action Corps, and you can have your own distro list that would be separate from the Action Corps, 290,000. And if you recruit female veterans across your state, we can have a distro list there. And although I'm a male senior vice commander, I will tell you that Virginia next year will be having a female veterans committee to advise me.
All right.
Yes.
Okay, it's me, Tina Shields. First off, whoever thought of the idea of an Action Corps email, I want to say thank you to Mr. Wise personally. Wise, I apologize. Thank you so much. I have learned and passed on so much from what I have gotten out of there. But the women's conference that was supposed to go on, I did not know anything about it until I went through some old Action Corps newsletters, and I found this. As soon as I got out of finished reading it, I went and signed up for the conference. I made my reservations at the hotel. I made my flight arrangements to get the summit, everything. And then I found out it was going to be canceled. I was like, but I did not know anything about this conference at all. No information on the VFW website, nothing coming down through the district, through the department, nothing about it other than what was put on there. So
sorry, may I first? Fortunately for Penn, he's the one who just clicks send, so it's actually incredible. I actually write up the stuff. 9 times out of 10, if there's anything related to women veterans of the Action Corps, it's me who wrote it. I do apologize for the VA Women's Summit, and I knew there was a gap, and it was very frustrating for me as well. Unfortunately for Kayla, she was told on very short notice when she was going to have the summit. Those original dates fell through. And I did not feel comfortable sending out more information for some that we didn't have dates for. And it did take a little bit of time before she was able to secure exact dates and location. So we have a monthly meeting with other VSOs and their Center for Women Veterans. And it's the first Wednesday of every month we go and have coffee and have a reserve room where we all talk. So as soon as I got those next dates on in one of those meetings, when we went to send out the Action Corps that Friday, was when we sent out the new information. But there was a few week period there where we just didn't have any forward moving information.
And also, mention again, if you are interested in getting updates from VA on issues relevant to women veterans, just go to our website, va.gov/womenvet, and you will get a not at all annoying pop-up that asks you what type of information you want to send for email updates on. You can pick news, events, research, messages from the center, and advisory committee on women veterans. And then we will send you email updates on a regular basis on any of the topics that you pick. So if you want to know from us directly what we're working, please just ask for those email updates and we will get them to you directly. As you mentioned, somebody else in the back mentioned, sometimes email kind of gets a little overwhelming. So instead of relying only on hearing it from one place, if you're hearing it from a bunch of different places, you're less likely to miss anything. So just go va.gov/womenvet, sign up for updates on whatever topics interest you. And if you know something that you want us to add to any of those, just shoot it my way. On our website, there's a email address where you can send information to us. So if there's an event in your state that I have missed, I try very hard to find things from across the country, but if there's an event relevant for women veterans in your state, shoot it to us, we'll add it to our events calendar. If there's a news article that is relevant to women veterans in your state that I've missed, send it to us, we'll get it added to the email list. So I would love to help raise awareness about anything that's happening at the local level, at our national level, and make this, you know, interactive. So please get my updates and give me stuff to add to them if I miss it, and I'd love to help raise that awareness for our group.
Yes, excuse me. My name is Susan Cuddy, and I'm from Post 8214 in Manchester, New Hampshire. What Senate meeting are you talking about? I have no idea.
So VA is hosting the National Women Veterans Summit next month. It's going to be in Houston.
Okay, and
the Hyatt Regency Houston, it's August 25th and 26th. And if you just go to our website, you'll get the link. You can click here to register. Looking forward to seeing many of you.
All right, ladies, so I just noticed that the app says this room is scheduled for 2 hours, but we scheduled it for just over an hour. So we have time for one more question, and then we can wrap it up, Cam, and I would assume if you have more questions, come up and we'll talk until they kick us out.
While we were discussing all this important information, a really important comrade of ours actually entered the room. And for those of you who are new to the VFW, this may be your first time, or you've never attended a women veteran meeting at national level, we had Priscilla Walkowitz came in. And I can tell you, if it wasn't for her hard work, we wouldn't even have a committee.
Thank you to everyone.